In this episode of Drinking Made Easy, we saunter into the Bayou State. We do a four-barrel shotgun.
It's craft beer at its finest.
Get all topsy-turvy at a local tap room.
This is called waterboarding in some countries.
And are offered to join in on a Tigerland initiation.
What are you wearing at the time?
You're wearing your birthday suit.
It's Drinking Made Easy, Baton Rouge. I'm Zane Lamprey, and my job is to drink. I'm traveling around with my mascot, Steve McKenna, and my buddy, Pleeplius, as we explore the local drinking cultures, customs, and cocktails. Along the way, we'll soak in the local flavor in an effort to make drinking easy. Baton Rouge is known for gators, crawfish, and tigers, but it's also made a jump into the craft beer scene. We pop into the relatively new Tin Roof Brewing Company for some cold beer. We sit down with William McGahee as he shows us the inspiration behind their seasonal watermelon wheat beer.
We're making our first seasonal to watermelon wheat beer. We were really just thinking of ideas of different kind of ways to use local ingredients. Watermelon wheats are kind of prevalent around the country, but nothing anywhere near here. So we thought it'd be a nice, refreshing wheat ale.
What do you need us to do?
Well, we're just cutting them in half, we're scooping them out and putting them in the bucket.
At what point in the process do these get integrated into the brew?
Towards the end of the boil, we're gonna dump this in.
So you're putting this in right in the beginning of the process?
Right.
So during the whole fermentation?
Right, it's still got the actual watermelon in there.
Okay, and with the wheat and watermelon, I mean, the flavors marry so well.
It's a very light flavor. It's more in the aroma. When you smell it, you're smelling watermelon. You know it's watermelon beer. And then in the taste, it's more of a hint. It's a light wheat beer, and you just want the light flavor of watermelon.
For their 900-gallon batch of beer, they'll use about 5 gallons of fresh local watermelon. This looks good, but since we won't be able to taste this for a few weeks, I'm forced to improvise. We pour some beer in our empty watermelon rinds and drink them.
Wow. Is it going to be good?
I think it's going to be wonderful.
All right.
After we all have a taste, we send Steve over to the mash tun with our fresh watermelon. On his way back, Steve grabs 2 six-packs of Tin Roof's Blonde and Amber Ale. Then it dawned on me. We shotgunned one beer in Miami. So I order up some duct tape.
What are you doing?
It's kind of an experiment. Do you know where I'm going with this?
I'm guessing.
But if I can poke a hole in the bottom of this can and make a good seal, I should be able to shotgun as many cans as I want.
But you're doing it wrong already.
Steve isn't putting this together.
I'm supposed to put it on the side, right here, the hole.
Yeah, see, he doesn't know what's going on.
So I open the bottom can and puncture the bottom of the top can.
That's step one.
Tape it shut.
There you go.
And it works.
That's it.
With a double barrel shotgun in the can, it's time for Steve to up the ante.
You want to try three?
I prep the upper cans, and Steve tapes them tightly together. Steve has a little spillage problem.
Come on, tape the top.
But we're still on track. Steve tapes it up. I puncture its bottom. It's time to go.
That's good strawberry bomb.
Holy cow!
You ready for four?
Not to be outdone in his own house, Will's volunteered to do four. We stack them up, Will sucks them down.
It's craft beer at its finest.
Good Lord.
Wow.
Oh, God.
It's probably best to leave it at that.
Nice work.
Yeah, very good.
Thank you, sir.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, Fae Do Do.
Hey! All right, I know.
Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. As you know, this is a TV show. It's also a drinking game.
And there are rules to the drinking game.
Yeah, for example, if you're hanging upside down, you probably have to do a shot.
Huh?
Go to drinkingmadeeasy.com for more rules. There you go. Just pour right in there.
Mm.
This is called waterboarding in some countries.
That's good stuff.
Yeah, okay.
We are drinking our way around the red stick, and our next stop is at the Chimes. With two locations in Baton Rouge, 50 beers on tap, the Chimes is the city's most popular destination for all things beer. They have 50 beers on tap and 130 in bottles. So it's no surprise that they're known for their beer cocktails. We jump behind the bar with Jessica Kessler to get the skinny on the Chimes.
What local beers do you guys have?
We've got Abita from Abita Springs.
Okay.
We have Nola. It's from New Orleans. It's right over there.
This right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we also have our own brewery in Baton Rouge, Tin Roof.
This is
Voodoo, and then we have the Blonde.
Tin Roof.
Yeah.
Okay. So you guys have some beer cocktails on the menu, but we could also just make our own up if we wanted to.
To speed up the process, we decide to experiment with some beer cocktails.
We'll all come up with one, and then whichever one is better, maybe that'll make its way to the menu. Got it.
So there you have it. Using beer from the three Louisiana breweries, they'll create three original beer cocktails. The winner will be immortalized on the Chimes menu. Let the Chimes begin. McKenna doesn't need time to think, so he'll have honors. Without hesitation, he goes straight for the Abita Turbo Dog.
Turbo Blonde.
And he tops it off with the Blonde from Tin Roof.
Yin and Yang beer.
There you have McKenna's Yin and Yang.
All right, go ahead.
Jessica is whipping up something she calls the Blonde Haze. It's half Tin Roof Blonde and half of Abita's Purple Haze. These beer cocktails look delicious, just making Lamprey a little nervous about the competition. His first move is the Tin Roof's Voodoo Bangle. Then he adds Abita's Turbo Dog and tops it off with Abita's Andy Gator. It's a concoction Lamprey's calling the Voodoo Turbo Gator.
Okay.
We bring in Pat the manager for a blind taste test. Pat starts with Lamprey's Voodoo Turbo Gator.
That was pretty good.
Thanks. I mean, that wasn't my...
Next is Jessica's Blonde Haze.
I don't like that one.
Then McKenna's Yin and Yang.
I like that one.
Oh, what?
And the clear winner is Lamprey.
He likes it so much, he's gonna take it with him.
Now that we've had a taste of the local beer scene, we make our way to Sammy's Grill, which is known for its boiled crawfish and a cocktail called the Fae Do Do. We'll get to the crawfish in a bit, but first, we start with the drink. The bar we're standing in opened in 1988. Since then, they've added three dining rooms and expanded to two other locations. We recruit Victoria Pittman to explain the roots of this Cajun expression.
What's a Fae Do Do?
It's a Cajun two-step line dance that we do in Louisiana.
Does anybody know the Fae Do Do? How to do the Fae Do Do? Ladies?
No takers, so Steve's on his own.
Yeah, yeah.
Now that we've danced it, it's time to make it.
Steve, you have a question. Go ahead.
Who invented the Fae Do Do?
For the answer to that question, we need to bring in Sammy's bar manager, Monica.
You are the inventor of the Fae Do Do.
Yes, I am.
Steve has some questions for you.
How many Fae Do Do's did you have the first time you made the Fae Do Do?
About three.
Wow.
Don't really remember much afterwards.
Why the name Fae Do Do?
Because it makes you just act a fool.
Fae Do Do is made with Southern Comfort, vodka, bourbon, amaretto, blue curacao, light rum, sweet and sour, orange juice, lemon lime soda, and grenadine.
Whew.
Start with three frosty pint glasses. Add Southern Comfort, vodka, bourbon.
I like the look of this Fae Do Do.
Some old New Orleans Cajun spiced rum.
You are going to be Fae Do Do-ing.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's Dodo. That's Dodo's.
And then amaretto, blue curacao.
Am I making them too strong, or is that how you normally make them?
That's perfect.
Sweet and sour mix, a dash of OJ.
Not too much.
A splash of lemon lime soda. Yeah.
That's it.
Okay.
Add ice and top with grenadine. And here at Sammy's, they garnish this beast with a cute little crawfish.
Man, everyone who
has seen the show knows what happens when you bust out straws.
When the straw goes in, the race must begin. And they're off. All three contestants are off to a good start. The winner of this race is the first person to finish their drink and eat the garnish. Nearing the bottom of the glass, it's neck and neck. Finished with their drinks, they move on to the crawfish. While Lamprey and Victoria employ the traditional pinch the head and squeeze the tail technique, McKenna stuffs the whole crawfish in his mouth. For his dedication, we'll give this race to McKenna.
And as promised, we all break out into a Fae Do Do. Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, Steve learns that he has Cajun ancestors.
The two dumbest people on the bayou, and they are the two smartest people on the bayou.
Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. We're here at the Chimes in Baton Rouge. We just invented a drink so good that they actually put it on the menu. It's called the Voodoo Turbo Gator. For more recipes, go to drinkingmadeeasy.com. We're in Baton Rouge, Louisiana at Sammy's Grill. We've had their famous drink, so now it's time to go see their famous crawfish. We swoop around back to get our talons in some crawfish because...
it's time for the six-pack challenge. Today's challenge is crawfish sorting. 70 pounds of live crawfish are dumped into the tank at the end of this industrial cleaner. Lamprey and McKenna will have to sort these small crustaceans by hand. The first to fill their 20-liter tub is the winner. And to make things interesting, they'll be doing it without protective gloves. They'll feel every pinch as they fight to fill their tub.
So these things bite?
Yeah. Normally, they do wear gloves when doing this.
Why are we not wearing gloves?
Because this is a challenge.
Okay.
The belt begins to roll, challenge begins. Afraid of the claws, these boys are taking it slow, grabbing one crawdaddy at a time.
Stop it.
Hey, stop it. Ow.
Lamprey and McKenna are too slow, and the crawfish are piling up.
Okay, we're gonna have a little bit of a backup.
This mound is making it more dangerous.
I don't know where to grab. I feel like one's crawling up my
leg. After 1 minute, they're neck and neck, reaching the 5-liter mark. McKenna finds an angry one, grabs him by the tail, and tosses him in the bucket. With a little ingenuity, Lamprey's able to get three for the price of one. While McKenna fights with one, Lamprey puts four more in his bucket. Lamprey's pulling into the leaves.
You have something to stir him up with?
To get things moving again, the crawfish are spread out.
Whoa, this is creepy, dude.
At a minute and a half, Lamprey is clearly ahead. Lamprey's using the crawfish claws against them.
See?
McKenna is really falling behind.
Yeah, look at that.
It looks like Lamprey's about to take a 2-1 lead for the season. Wanting to win, McKenna puts his fear aside, grabs a large clump of crawfish, and throws it in the bucket.
Good job.
Another large handful evens it up.
Steve, you can't drop them. You got to pick them.
McKenna's really moving a lot of these little lobsters.
Don't call interference on me.
McKenna's pulling back into the race. It's now neck and neck. It's going to be a photo finish.
Come on!
With three more large handfuls, McKenna's bucket is full, and McKenna wins this week's six-pack challenge.
Come on, baby! Woo! Yeah!
With Steve riding high after that victory, we head to a downtown bar with some Cajun flair. We enlist the help of Roger Pastor and Megan Rainers to teach Steve the bar's name.
All right, Steve, the name of this place is...
Thibodeaux and Thibodeaux.
Wait. Can you help him, please?
Boudreaux and Thibodeaux.
Boudreaux and Thibodeaux.
Nope.
Steve needs a little motivation.
No!
I just... Boudreaux.
Okay, Boudreaux and Thibodeaux.
Thank you very much. So the owners of this place are not Boudreaux and Thibodeaux.
No, Boudreaux and Thibodeaux are more a statement than an actual person.
Boudreaux and Thibodeaux are the two dumbest people on the bayou, and they are the two smartest people on the bayou.
All right,
they know everything, but they don't know nothing.
All right, with that cleared up, it's time to try a cocktail that's guaranteed to make you Boudreaux and Thibodeaux, called the Gator Tea.
Pretty sure we're getting the Gator Tea.
You guys can share a Gator Tea. How about that? Oh, that's nice. Oh, that's real, real nice.
Our first drink is the Gator Tea, which is made with vodka, tequila, gin, rum, melon liqueur, sour apple liqueur, sweet and sour, and lemon lime soda. Start with some ice. Then, equal parts vodka, tequila, gin, and rum. Add equal parts melon liqueur and sour apple liqueur. Top with sweet and sour and a splash of lemon lime soda.
Good.
Tad the sound guy's looking thirsty, so I decide to let him have a sip.
It's a fun game. Everybody likes to play it. It's called You Guys versus Tad the Sound Guy.
When the straw goes in, the race must begin.
Go.
And they're off. Even though Team McKenna has twice the sucking power, Tad keeps pace.
This drink appears to be too much for Megan to handle, but luckily her teammate sucks enough to take home the win. And in second place...
Oh, yes! Tad the Sound Guy!
Louisiana may be known for black magic, but I don't want to mess with no bad mojo, so Roger suggests I try their voodoo punch, which is made with monkey coconut rum, melon liqueur, orange juice, pineapple juice, and cranberry juice. Into a skull cup, pour equal parts monkey coconut rum and melon liqueur, then a splash of orange, cranberry, and pineapple juice.
Let's chug the skull.
Let's chug the skull, man.
Keeping up with Roger, he insists that we down it real fast.
Come on, Zane. Pretend you have a drinking show.
Oh!
Was it
he got him! You got him!
I let him win.
You got him!
Can I punch him?
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, the Cracky Sack.
Poured down their back.
Okay.
Down their sack.
Yeah.
And caught with a cup.
Hey, everybody, I'm Pleblius. If you want to know what really went on behind the scenes, follow Zane on Twitter at Zane Lamprey.
We're imbibing our way through the capital of Louisiana, and our last stop is in Tigerland. Fred's is a place that's known to sometimes get a little out of control. Today will be no exception. To get the lay of the land, we meet up with Harry Rome, who appears to have gotten started without us.
Fred's has been here since 1982.
Okay, tell me about Tigerland. What's Tigerland?
Tigerland's been around for a while. There's one, two, three, four, there's six bars in Tigerland.
Okay,
and
it's off campus?
Off campus.
Okay. Steve, you were a good student, right?
On a scale of 1 to 10, I was like a, can I get a beer?
Yeah. You start off with a Beta Strawberry Harvest Lager, made in Abita Springs, about an hour and a half outside of Baton Rouge.
Steve!
Get over there.
This place, every now and then, gets a little rowdy.
Yeah, to say the least.
Okay, what are you guys known for? The snorkel shop.
Yeah, we do snorkels over
here. Okay, what the hell is that?
Snorkel is gray vodka and Sprite and cranberry on top. The way that you take the snorkel is why the name snorkel came out.
Okay, we'll have three of those, please.
Three snorkels?
Yeah.
Sure.
You know what? Four. Mel, you probably want one, right?
I know how much Mel likes vodka, so I'll make one for her anyway. To reiterate, snorkel shot is made with grape vodka, lemon lime soda, and cranberry juice. Start by pouring grape vodka into an iced rocks glass, then add a splash of lemon lime soda and a splash of cranberry juice. The method of consumption is tricky, so we ask Harry to demonstrate.
You take a snorkel, you just put your hand like this,
okay,
and put it on top of the shot.
Okay.
And you throw it.
Wait, you're calling that a shot?
This is a shot.
Okay.
This is a shot.
Where are we?
If you're in Baton Rouge, you throw your hand over it. You leave a little opening because you're going to throw it over this way.
Okay.
So it doesn't spill on you.
Oh, I got it.
Cheers.
The snorkel shot may at first seem like it defies physics, but it actually works.
Did you spill? No spillage?
No.
Hey, that's how you do it, though.
Now it's Steve's turn, and he has his own method using his gorilla hands. And that, surprisingly, works as well.
Who's your daddy now?
Come on, Mel.
I wish I could.
But?
But I'm physically unable to do that glass.
I'm infuriated at you right now.
He's infuriated at you. Sorry, Mel.
Even if that's a word or not, I don't care.
To keep Harry from becoming infuriated, Mel gives in. Mel takes off her Drinking Made Easy hoodie, and that's enough to make our overhead camera faint.
That thing.
Jesus. Oh. Did you get that? Yeah. Are you okay, little buddy?
Sure, why not?
Just dump her down.
Mel seems to be getting the hang of it, which is asking to be tickled.
Who's the producer?
Wow, I like that.
No, no, get up, get up, get off the bus.
I hope that thing hits you back.
All right, all right, all right. Rocky, sit down.
You know what? I did it for the love of the game. That's it.
Where are you going?
Get out of my way, Scooter.
Where are you going? And as Steve heads to the bathroom, it's time to call it a night. That's the freezer.
Let's go.
All right, I guess we're done. Let's shut the cameras off and you guys can all drink.
Hold on. We gotta do a Cracky Sack.
Okay, hold on a second. Bring it in. Tell me what it is.
Cracky Sack, we reserve the right to employees. We stand up on the bar.
Yeah.
And the employee is given a bottle of Jack Daniels.
Okay.
And it is poured down their back.
Okay.
Down their sack.
Yeah.
And caught with a cup.
Yeah.
And then that person takes it or somebody else takes it.
Okay, so what are you wearing at the time?
You're wearing your birthday suit.
Okay, wait, what happens if the person doesn't have a sack, if it's a girl?
It's called the clam slam.
Steve comes back just in time.
Hey, how about this, Steve? I'll do a crack sack, you do a crack sack. Zane takes your shot.
No.
Red will take my shot. Somebody's taking somebody's goddamn crack sack around this bitch. Steve!
Listen, I stopped.
Do a goddamn crack sack.
I'm not crack slapping it.
Why has someone barred the door? You got Bruce Springsteen, he's not gonna let anybody out until he's like, do it.
Volunteer. We got a third volunteer.
You gotta take your shirt off.
Oh, yeah.
Whoa, whoa.
Woo!
You gotta take your clothes off.
Against his better judgment, Steve gives in. He joins the guys on the bar for what's known as a cracky sack.
Oh, God! Oh, God! Damn!
Aaron, don't hurt yourself.
Yes. Check us out on Facebook and at drinkingmadeeasy.com.